Bob LeFevre, I think, is known by so many people, it's a little embarrassing to introduce him. But so I think maybe it's best if I just say this very fine gentleman is, I think, known by most of us as a writer and a lecturer and a founder of Rampart College, Rampart Institute, I guess, in the Colorado Mountains. I like to think of him as an electric speaker. Anyway, please make welcome Bob LeFevre.
Thank you very much, Earl. I hope my speech isn't that shocking to you, but I am very pleased to be here again. I was here, in fact, there have been so many meetings recently that I'm almost meeting myself coming home as I go out. Our discussion this evening is going to be, the title of it is Instead of Morality. And I want to begin by stating flatly that I am a moralist, which means that I have to go a little bit beyond myself in order to cover my topic. I want to clear up what I mean when I say that I'm a moralist. I'm very conscious of Mark Twain's observation that, which I'm amending slightly, I think what he said was, nothing needs reform so much as other people's habits. And then in another context, nothing needs reform so much as other people's morals. And in my own case, I am, I trust, not that kind of moralist. I am a moralist for the following reason. I want to set that down so that we are, that you are in communication not just with the words that I put out, but with my motivation in putting them out. When I first became a libertarian, if I may use the term, which now applies to so many things, I don't know that it has any specific meaning, but when I first became convinced, let me paraphrase, that there had to be a better way to organize human society than an institution built upon the concept of violence, retribution, retaliation, vengeance, and war. We've got to do better than that. And the consequence was that when I began to study this matter philosophically, I realized that what I had to do for myself was to come up with a philosophy, a system of thought based upon nature's realities, which would be an improvement on what we had. There wasn't any point in my mind, and there still isn't, of getting rid of what we have just for the joy of the exercise. If we can't make things better, at least to some degree, as a result of this effort, let's not make the effort. So I am at once confronted in my thinking with the necessity of measuring something that is better than what we have. And that means exploration into the field of what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad, and that makes me a moralist. Because anyone concerned in this area is concerned with finding some way of getting through this extremely difficult and complex area. So, most of us have tended to think that morality is whatever the church has said. Others of us have tended to feel that morality is whatever the law says. That is, as a matter of fact, is probably the prevalent view in the United States as of this moment, that law and what is right are two terms meaning essentially the same thing. The law is presumed to be correct. Therefore, a violation of a law is presumed to be a violation of a morally proper procedure. I would have to challenge that. Of course, there is the anarchist notion, which I heard enunciated as recently as yesterday at a meeting, that whatever the government law may say is wrong, and consequently, breaking a law is, by definition, a positive good. I don't know that I care to endorse that. In fact, this was precisely the thing that happened to me in trying to think my way through as a moral philosopher. I began to realize that there wasn't a single philosopher I could name or whom I had studied that didn't have parts of his or her philosophy that seemed to me to be either wrong or incorrectly emphasized, that is, overly emphasized where it should not have been, or avoided or omitted altogether when I thought it was important. In other words, I didn't find any philosopher that agreed with me. And of course, I was right. Oh, that was the thing that hit me finally. And it took a long time before I was willing to really admit this. But I haven't yet really found anybody that is perfect, even me. Now, of course, I made up my mind quickly about everybody else. But I finally discovered that everybody has clay feet to some degree. And that made it possible for me to take a look at other people and become discriminating. And ladies and gentlemen, I recommend this as a primary mental attitude. We have a tendency, perhaps it's an American trait, perhaps it is a tribute to our youthfulness as a people, but we tend to go whole hog on people. We either love them, we adore them, we adulate them, we put them on pedestals, or we despise them, we abhor them, we hate them, we detest them. And we can't find anything in between. Let somebody be on a pedestal, and then we find a flaw, and you hear the water running, and you know it where it went. This is characteristic. For example, I know many people who have received great help, some wisdom, and some brilliant assistance from Rand. I know others who have found contradictory assistance from Mises. Which of them is wrong? Well, let's not talk about who is wrong, who is absolutely wrong, absolutely right. I found flaws in both, and I found help in both. And I have found this to be true with just about everybody I have known. Ladies and gentlemen, this will come as a shock, but I expect that even the Ayatollah Khomeini was nice to his mother. He is not exactly a symbol of adoration, at least in my book. But at the same time, I have tried to get rid of this idea of having some kind of a symbol. People, I think, we do better. I think we come closer to reality when we look at things as they are and we look at people as they are and we accept them for what they are, realizing that none is perfect and at the same time that none is without some merit. And then you discriminate. And you select the people that have the most merit, as you see it, and you avoid those that have not enough merit for you to bother with, as you see it. And I think that's the best way it works. Anyway, I think that is what I have to do when I take a look at the prohibitions of the church. I have found some of the things in various religions to be helpful. I have also found things in most religions to be a little bit ridiculous. I have found some of the things in government to be things that I would hope we would have, which we are presently now getting from government. I would agree with the anarchists that there is something fundamentally wrong here, because government, whatever it may do that may turn out to be fairly good in the end, is nonetheless done in the worst possible way. But I can't say that every achievement is in itself wrong. For example, we have government libraries. I don't think a library per se is a bad thing. However, I do not agree with socialized housing for books. There are other ways to have books. I'm not against books. So if the government has books, that doesn't make books bad. The same is true with hospitals. There are government hospitals. I don't favor government having hospitals, but a hospital isn't all bad. Of course, there are doctors and doctors. And doctors' bills and doctors' bills. I understand all this. But people, if we stop painting each other in total colors and accept the concept of discrimination, selection, and use it keenly, I think we will begin to appreciate just what we have in life, and we'll begin to appreciate our friends even more, because we will know that they are not perfect and we can love them anyway. Ah, that's a breakthrough. Well, I was not satisfied with the morality of the church, and I certainly was not satisfied with the idea that government and law, that government and rightness are the same thing. Clearly not. So I tried to turn to what I call natural law to find a source for what is right and what is wrong for human beings to do. Now, I spelled this out a little bit at the last meeting that I attended in this room, sponsored by a different supper club, and I think I was so keenly interested on that occasion to simplify and say no more than I intended to say that I think I oversimplified it and didn't sum it up as well as I should have. Because in point of fact, the concept of natural rights and the concept of a natural morality, or if you care to go with this, a concept of scientific morality is so blame simple that you can hardly believe it. And I recognized finally, of course, after the meeting was over the last time, that what I should have said, you know, so often this happens, you think of your very best stuff while you're asleep, you know, and it wakes you up. Anyway, that is what happened to me. Why didn't I say that at the time? Almost everybody looks at natural law as though, if it existed, the forces of nature would themselves enforce the law, like the law of gravity. And, of course, the law of gravity is one that nature does enforce. If you jump off a place that is too high for you, whatever your wishes may be, or whatever your ideas may be, the law of gravity will work, and you will come to the next resting place, however far down that may be. If it's a long way down, you may not arrive in good shape. But down you'll come. And I think people, in fact, one of the one of the guests at that meeting sort of challenged me with that idea. Where could I demonstrate that nature enforces this concept? And people, nature doesn't enforce mathematics either. Mathematics is an abstraction. It's a code. It makes it possible for us to deal in what we call a science of numbers. But is it possible for one to make a mistake? And if you do make a mistake, does nature hit you? No, you just come up with the wrong answer. Well, I think that's the same kind of thing that we have here. Nature doesn't hit you in this case, but if you don't understand scientific morality or the concept of natural rights, your own mistake gets to you. It isn't nature coming along and hitting you. Lightning doesn't come out of the sky and strike you and say, naughty, naughty, you shouldn't have done that. So if you're expecting that to happen, I'm going to have to disappoint you. I don't think it will. But that doesn't mean that there isn't a natural law that can be observed. You see, there are no guarantees. You can go right ahead and add up your column of figures and get a wrong answer every time. And nature doesn't care. There will be no weeping of the willow because you get come up with a wrong answer. You just don't have the benefit of the right answer. Okay? I hope I've made that point. So what I felt was needed in this area was an understanding of human nature as well as the nature of the world we're in, because it seemed to me that man, qua man, has a real nature. It's a fact. Human nature is a fact. Of course, I have been influenced on this point considerably by Mises and the concept of human action, and the concept that human action can be examined from a scientific point of view, not from a scientific point of view where you have to count and measure. Science does not require that except in certain types of experiments. You don't have to quantify everything, and still you can be scientific. You can observe how things work. And you can observe that if they are put together in a certain way, benefits accrue that do not accrue if they are put together differently. So this is what we all do. We exercise the faculty of judgment. We learn to discriminate, and we learn how to put the pieces together. Now, having reached the idea that this was the problem, I had to get into this area to see if I could find something to guide myself so that I could offer something that would improve on the situation. It became quite clear, the more I read history and the more I studied this whole area, that almost without exception, the conflicts which engulf humankind are conflicts relating to this ultimate question: who gets to control how much of what? In other words, the questions that beset us and befuddle us are questions relating to property. Who owns what? How does he get to own it? How much does he own? What is ownership? Well, what is property? How do these things work? Well, I'm not going to deliver, you may relax on this one, I'm not going to deliver a dissertation on property tonight, though it might very well be appropriate. I'm going to cut right across it to say that, to reach a conclusion, which I'm not going to attempt to illustrate because it takes much too long, merely to tell you that I finally, after working it over, came to the conclusion that there are two ways that human beings relate to property. One, they can own it. Two, they can possess it. Or three, they don't either own it or possess it. So when we come to a relationship, we either own, or we possess, or we don't. All right. Now then, the difference between owning and possessing, I saw very quickly, both in terms of the chronology of development and the chronology of improving standards of living for humankind, related to the discovery and the development of what I will call the moral law. And it was based on property. And it emerged here. So long as property was merely possessed, then the party having the greatest property, the greatest amount of property, would be the biggest bully in the block. Possession, in fact, we have an old saying dating from this, possession is 9 parts of the law. Well, it became virtually 10 parts of the law because there was no law. If you are a 600-pound anthropoid, and the old question, where does a 400-pound gorilla sleep? And your answer is, anywhere he wants to. Of course, when we live at a time when possession is the only rule, the party with the biceps makes the choices. And the rest of us say, yes, whatever. But that isn't satisfactory when we once begin to acquire significant amounts of property. And you know who it isn't satisfactory to is the guy with the biceps. Because he suddenly finds himself confronted with a dreadful problem. And this certainly occurs when we begin to acquire land. You see, his possession depends upon his physical presence. Because if he turns his back and walks off, the property he left behind is up for grabs. But when he begins to get a lot of property, he can't carry it all with him. And if he tries to acquire land, he can't carry that with him at all. So how does he make certain that it is still his property during his absence? Ladies and gentlemen, that question and the resulting experiments that were done in little islands of human experience called tribes and clans and villages and so on are the scientific laboratories where we have worked this whole thing out, and we have realized that we have a kind of conduct which benefits by far and away most people. And that is a recognition that even though a person might be capable of taking the property of another, it's proper for him not to. Not because he might be punished by the gorilla type when he gets back, but because in the final analysis, he hopes one time to have property too, and if we can build up a concept of leaving each other's property alone and letting people continue to own even during their absence, then and only then do we have a rising standard of living, because without it, each of us has to sit there and stand guard over whatever it is that we own, and we never have time to produce enough to be worth much. In fact, we don't produce enough to be worth stealing. It's only when we can put it down and leave it alone and walk off and are yet secure enough to come back and find it where we left it, that mankind's civilization begins to take off. So this is where we make the discovery concerning the difference between correct and incorrect conduct. Correct conduct, and this has been stated in many ways. I'm not going to attempt to state it in a way that runs counter to whatever you find attractive, but I'm speaking of the thing itself. This has been stated as the golden rule. It has been stated in at least five of the Ten Commandments. It has been stated in the Code of Hammurabi, I don't remember the exact amount, something like 130 of Hammurabi's laws ended in the death penalty, and most of them were merely repetitions describing what would befall you if you stole something. More or less, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, which is where that saying comes from. But in the end, it works out that when we begin to teach each other through our habits, we don't form schools and sit down and learn lessons with homework and so on. We learn through doing, and we interact with our fellows, and we learn that when we practice moral restraint, that is to say, we are in a position where we could injure our neighbor, but we don't. We are then in the moral theater. We could perform badly, but we'd perform well instead, just as we are doing here tonight. This little lady is trying to collect money, and she's doing a good job of it. But if she failed to leave someone a check, I would anticipate that thanks to your training and your background, you would go out, and before leaving, you would go up to her and say, I didn't get a check. Could I take care of it now? Or some such thing. Why do we do that? We do that because we have been inculcated with these ideas. These are the moral notions that we operate from, and they are predicated upon boundary, which is a fundamental of all property, value, which is a fundamental of all property, and control, that is to say, the ability of the possessor to take control of his property in such a way that he becomes the exclusive decision maker over that property, even in his absence, and other people respect it. Not because of the force that he could bring to bear, but because that is the proper way to proceed. And I might point out, ladies and gentlemen, that when you have a reversion, that is, once you take a civilization that has advanced along the moral line to a point where preponderance of moral rectitude exists over property, and then you begin to go the other way, as is happening in this country now, and has in fact been happening in a major way in this country since the 60s. We started into a decline in terms of property there. Of course, intellectually, we began a decline with the emergence of communist theory, which theorized in this direction, but we have been practicing it more and more. Our own government, as you know, is very largely communistic. They adopt communism in order to fight it, which you're well aware of. We are entering into this period, or well into this period, of decline. Now, when this happens, we don't swing back the way we had been before. What happens is that we rely more and more upon theft. And, of course, we use the government as our model, but we end up with more and more people stealing more and more things, and the moral position declines and finally vanishes, and your civilization collapses. So actually, civilization, ladies and gentlemen, is built on a moral law relating to property. Now, the church has led you to believe that morality has to do with sex, or that it has to do with diet. In fact, the earliest church laws related to diet and to sex, which, by the way, is the only way to get a good church going if you want a church, because what you want to do is find out what people like the most and prohibit it. And then they will turn to you for permission to do what they normally would do, and then you've got the power to grant it or withhold it, you see. And that puts you in the driver's seat. So if you want to start a religion, begin by prohibiting the things that you know people are going to do anyhow, and then you've got the guilt trick you can lay on them, and you can get money for this. That's a practical procedure. But I don't. I'm not talking about that. That's ridiculous. Real morality relates to property, and of course the government's idea is that legislation is moral. The government, I'm afraid, would not understand morality if it were a bear and walked up and bit them. If immorality were an alley, the government would be a boulevard. The government is simply engaged in saying, whatever we say is right because we said it was. And, of course, you now find what is particularly amusing, every time we step off the earth and look back, if only we weren't here now, we could see it with greater detachment. The courts themselves are now reversing themselves, sometimes almost in the same week. They are where they used to uphold the moral concept, they are now fudging on it and finding ways and means of explaining that what is called, I think, among some attorneys, and there are many of them here, and I'm sure they will hasten to straighten me out. I have many friends who straighten me out all the time, and I need it. It's called the deep pockets theory. They find out when something goes wrong, who around the geographical location where it went wrong has the deepest pocket, and you find that party guilty. Now, this works out. And it's the current theory that they're working on, which does, of course, pay off, but it's kind of an unhappy one. Okay. Now what I've talked about is the concept of morality and where it came from. Very briefly, I haven't done a thorough job. I understand that because I'm now ready to cross the barrier to say instead of morality. There is, I'll wait for my friend Cy here. I know he wants to do this. There we are. Ladies and gentlemen, instead of morality, once the concept of non-theft has been recognized, I am not at all certain but what there is a simpler procedure, though I don't quite know how to get beyond the teaching of the boundary. Somebody approached me before my talk and said, morality, as far as I'm concerned, relates to the end of my nose. This is me, and if anybody violates that, they're wrong. And I agree, that's true. But what I'm getting at is called manners. Morals and manners have always been closely associated in philosophy, partly because many philosophers view manners as simply another way of expressing morality, because many philosophers don't believe there is such a thing as morality, and consequently they merely turn to custom, the mores of a people, and say, well, that's it, and that's merely the manners, the usages, whatever, and they drop it at that point. They have not come up with what I have just run through for you. So that's one of the reasons the concept of morals and manners have been closely tied together. But I see manners as going beyond that, and let me make this clear at the outset. I am not talking here about etiquette. There's a difference between knowing which fork to pick up and good manners. You see, a person of good manners could probably pick up the wrong fork. and nothing would be made of it, and if the people sitting next to him or near him all knew that he had picked up the wrong fork, it still wouldn't make any difference, because if they had enough good manners, they would never reveal that their neighbor had made the error, because they have too many manners to give it away. Well, what then do I mean by good manners? Well, you know, the concept of ownership and the concept of possession depends upon boundaries. And it gives us moral absolutes. I agree. This is my nose, and I'm the only one that gets to blow it. And if anybody punches it, I'm going to be unhappy about it. What I may do beyond that to show my unhappiness is a matter of judgment on my part, and I hope, under stress, that I will be wise. Being French, I cannot assure that. I'm not always wise, so please watch it when you see my nose. But manners goes beyond this. You see, ladies and gentlemen, there are properties, and I'm using property now in its second important point. We use the term property to denote anything that is subject to ownership, but we also use it as revealing the characteristic of something. We say that the property of these ashtrays consists of glass, and your tumblers have the property of glass. And we use the term property in that respect as well, as to denote something that is owned or could be owned. There are many properties, there are many things that exist where the boundaries are either indistinct or undetermined, or possibly even indeterminate at the present time in terms of our existing technology. A good case in point is a very, very hot issue at the moment, where the people in Los Angeles have just made us more moral by passing a regulation demanding that all businessmen employing, 3, 4, 5 people provide a non-smoking area. And the reason is because we have not yet been able to figure out who owns how much of the air in a room. The air in the room doesn't have specific boundaries. We've got 40 people in this room or thereabouts, and how much of the air in here is yours? I don't know. So far, there's enough for all of us, I'm happy to say. But maybe my piece is over there and I'm breathing somebody else's. I don't know. We don't know because our technology doesn't tell us. So the air in this room is either owned by the people that own the building, and I don't know who that is. Could be a holding company. Could be a hold-up company. I don't know what it is. There are rumors. But it's a cinch that I don't own it. In fact, that's the one thing I do know about property. I can tell what I own. I don't know what you own. I don't own the building, but somebody or something, some agency, organization, corporation, partnership, something owns this. And because they put a boundary around the air, I guess they own the air in here. But they're nice about it. They're letting us use it. So, okay, fair enough. Well, that's one place. How do we get along with smokers if we don't smoke? How many of us have good manners in this regard? I might suggest, ladies and gentlemen, that when you find an individual who happens to have impeccable manners, that individual is not going to be giving you any problem about violating boundaries. That's not the kind of fellow, a girl, that goes out and becomes a thief, a rapist, or a murderer, I would think, as a rule. Not if they continue to exercise good manners. they just isn't their line of tricks. So, what do we do in this area? And you can think, I'm sure, of many other areas. A person with good manners allows for the possible ignorance or weakness of the other party. Maybe there is a boundary there that we have not yet discerned. But a party having good manners recognizes that everybody doesn't think the same way. A person who smokes may have compulsions that are totally unknown to the person who objects. Now, if the person who smokes has good manners, that person will be concerned with the fact that he conceivably might be making someone else unhappy, ill, or at least bilious. And so he might be very careful about it. But if he weren't, the party that is being injured, if that party has good manners, would probably just excuse him or herself and move away, rather than having a confrontation in which I demand that you stop, or you demand that I start, or whichever. Actually, I do smoke. I would rather do that than burst into flame. I usually smoke when I'm writing, which is exactly what people say when they read my stuff. They say, well, it's, you can tell what the product is. But that's the point that I'm making. We can think of other places. Take sounds as another case in point. Where are the boundaries to noises? And what is a noise to you may be music to someone else. My father was tone deaf. It was all noise to him. You could play a beautiful piece for him, and it was just noise. It wasn't beautiful at all. So the important thing for him was to keep the decibels down, whatever it was. With other people today, the important thing is put the decibels up. They can't even hear it. Of course, after a while, they're impaired and they can't hear it at all. Well, I don't know that. Though I have seen a growing tendency that way, it may be true. Anyway, where's the boundary? Well, it's not discernible. We know we can find the origin. We know where we can find out where the noise originated. But what if a person is deaf and doesn't hear it? There are no boundaries for him. Nothing bothers him. There may be advantages there. But someone who has very, very acute hearing and who finds that even music is just noise, boy, playing a beautiful melody to him is like, running your fingernail perhaps over the blackboard and really giving him a shock. How do you deal with this? The moral law won't tell you. But manners could tell you. You don't intrude. If you like music, be sure that others like it too. Or be sure that as you play it, you are not intruding on others who may have other things to do, don't want to be jangled at the time, and so on. And if you do like it, then you can let people know that you do, and you can work in that area. And not just music, but various sounds. There is a kind of noise, and it's noise. I know it's noise. There's a kind of noise that I like. I warm up to it. I wouldn't tell you this, but my wife isn't listening, so I'll let you know. the sound of her in the kitchen, and all she's doing is making a little clatter, and you just don't know, but that will actually cause me to salivate. It's a marvelous sound. Now, if I heard it someplace else, I probably wouldn't like it at all. But anyway, you see, where's the boundary to that? Well, in my house, I hope there isn't any. But in somebody else's house, it might make me nervous. I don't know. People are different. We're all different in things. And what about odor? Here's something else. Again, we can probably trace down an odor and find its source. But we know the source of the odor, whoever owns the source, perpetrated the odor. But what is your sense of smell? How acutely do you become aware of odors? And what do you think of them anyway? Do you like them or don't you? Well, I guess there are pleasant odors and unpleasant odors. As a pipe smoker, I found after I'd smoked a pipe for some time, I virtually lost my sense of smell, which is too bad because I now have to depend on my hearing to know that the food is being fixed, so I don't smell the food. I'd love to smell the food, but I get my salivation out of the clatter, which is marvelous. So you see, nature compensates. But others have great ecstasy in various aromas which they admire and love, the roses, the perfume, the this, that, and the other. And then there are, of course, unpleasant odors, and I have a memory, I can remember them too. But where's the boundary, and how do we deal with them? Well, the same rule applies. Ladies and gentlemen, where the question of morality may not provide an answer, the question of manners always can. Now, if you think a little bit beyond this, you're going to see something else. Ladies and gentlemen, if you really have good manners, the question of where the boundary is, even when you can discern it, isn't really all that important to you, because you're not taking things down to the wire. You're giving the other party the benefit of the doubt. When he says, "This is my property," you accept it, provided it isn't your property. And you don't accept it by saying, "Okay, show me your boundaries." You just accept it, and you respect it, even though if you were to examine it, you might discover that he's exaggerated a bit. And he's told you that he has more than he has. I have, believe it or not, detected that tendency in a large number of people. We tend to overstate our own significance, either in terms of our personalities, our achievements, or what we own. So we sometimes, this is my house, but actually the bank owns it. I have an equity in it, but other people really own it, if you want to be truthful about it, and so on. Again, I think you see my point. If we had, or if we could, develop a society filled with people who had good manners and who recognized with the arts of discrimination where the boundaries are, when they are visible and determinable, but don't let that hang you up, when they nonetheless practice good manners anyway, I wonder if we wouldn't have a much happier, more gentle, more constructive kind of social arrangement. Be fun to try. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Sir,
Earl?
You've been talking about good manners.
I hope so.
And maybe I missed a sentence or two. It's possible. Could you be a little, could you get specific about what you consider good manners?
Yes. Let me say it a different way. I consider good manners consideration for the other party. And consideration expressed in these scientific terms, if you like. When I find where the boundary is between my property and my neighbor's, it turns out that that boundary is a line on the map or a fence. But it is good manners for me to presume that my neighbor even has an interest on my side of the fence. Now, legally, he doesn't. Morally, he doesn't. Morally, I can be precise. I own to that fence, period. But from a standpoint of good manners, it might be very nice for me not to stack garbage on my side of the fence. I'm at liberty to do that. It's my property. But I'm quite sure he wouldn't like that. And if I have trees along that line, it might be a good idea for me to communicate with him about the leaves that may be falling in his yard, or the trunks of the trees that may enlarge and end up being apparently partly his. Technically, I suppose he could come in with a rip saw and saw the trees in half. I would hope he wouldn't, and I would work, or try to. I think good manners would say, why don't we work this out? That's what I mean by good manners. You communicate, you give the benefit of the doubt to the other party, and if he has good manners too, he'll give you the benefit of the doubt as well. That's what I mean. Does that help? Okay. Sir. Yes, but it is tolerance spelled out particularly as an extrapolation from a moral position. I think I haven't thought about it enough yet, but it seems to me that this goes beyond morality because it solves, or it offers, it doesn't solve precisely, but it offers possible solutions where morality has virtually nothing to say. So in that sense, it does go beyond. Instead of morality, works where the boundaries aren't there, or can work. But then, of course, when you get right down to it, nothing works absolutely anyway, so this will work as well as anything else. And I'm quite certain that if we had people who would practice tolerance, to use your term, and who would recognize that other people make mistakes, and that does not make them into villains. It makes them into human beings like ourselves, because we too make mistakes. And then if we find that we are rubbing their fur the wrong way, we can find that out and correct it, and or try to. I think it's the way to go. I recommend the procedure, sir.
Yes, in your first talk where you defined morality in terms of ownership,
yes,
and boundaries,
yes,
and that type of thing.
Yes.
Now tonight you took that a step further and defined it in terms of not only the ownership, but going a step further in terms of the golden rule, which I think is fantastic. If you really step back and take a look at it, though, once I get down to the point of the golden rule, do I then still need the concept of ownership and boundaries?
Well, that's why I haven't done enough thinking here yet. I don't really know. It strikes me that in the world that we have, given human development to its present state, that morality is a precursor to manners, not the other way around. I wouldn't have tumbled to the concept of good manners had it not been that I had already found what I thought was a scientific morality. And then I continued to be confronted with a problem. How do I deal with this place where we cannot find the boundary? And I realized.
The answer to that, I believe, is the golden rule.
Well, the golden rule doesn't quite satisfy me either all by itself. It depends on how it's interpreted, it seems to me. Maybe we should talk about this some other time. Yes, Dagny?
It seems to me that what you're talking about more than morality is common sense. And this isn't really a question, but just some ideas I'd like you to maybe comment on. I'm always curious whether common sense is something that people are born with and then they lose it or untaught it or something, or whether common sense is something that can be taught or acquired in some way. And to me, that's something that we have to, you know, why don't all of these things, the manners, property rights, gold, that's all common sense. Why isn't there more of it going around? What can we do to increase the level of common sense, which seems to be lacking in the human race?
Well, Dagny, you know, that's the reason I became a libertarian, is because it seemed like common sense to me, too, when I sat down and thought about it. But I suppose the real problem with common sense is that it's so very rare. So it really isn't common. So I think maybe some people have a predilection toward it, but some don't seem to. And this is why I think it's so vital for them to understand the nature of human liberty. Because, of course, liberty also falls into this same category. Liberty is a word that arises for use in the moral theater. It's one of the things that I find vital. So I can't answer your question. I really don't know why there is common sense is so rare. But I agree, it is. Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Can't you use the term consideration for others as a sort of a synonym for manners?
Yes, indeed. Sure, why not? Whatever term seems comfortable for you. I am not a pedant, ladies and gentlemen. I have great respect for those who are, but I like people to use the terms that they find accommodate their thinking. I use the words that fit myself, and I try to make myself understood, and I'm sure that each of you could say what I've said, and in your own words say it better than I've said it, only I've tried to communicate with all of you, and probably I wouldn't understand some of what you would say to me. I've tried to reach a common denominator in my words so that you would all at least get the meaning that I intend to communicate. That's what I try to do. Any other questions? In the back, yes.
What do you feel that manners breaks down in a more formal sort of morality has to take over? For instance, it seems like the manners would work real well on an individual basis. You know, I'm sure I don't mind if you smoke, you know, it's going to bother my dinner, but it's okay because it's kind of temporary and it's person to person. It seems that that's fairly different from an alfalfa plant growing up next to my house where the smell is going to be there all the time. And I'm not talking to my neighbor, but to a company. Where do you see, you know, where does the manners sort of break down?
Well, the manners breaks down just about where the morality breaks down. In other words, what you've expressed is that you wouldn't like it if an alfalfa plant went there, even if they had the moral prerogatives of putting it there. So the matter of manners wouldn't help you, and the matter of morals probably wouldn't help you. You still wouldn't like it. And I can sympathize with that. One of the difficulties that we have here is, I suppose, a failure on the part of our educational system to correctly inform us of the nature of reality. The fact is that you cannot control the actions of other people. You could kill them. And if they wish to be influenced, you might be able to persuade them and demonstrate and etc. and get them to change their minds. But they have to change their minds. You can't change them. You can change your own mind, but it's the only mind you have dominion over. So if somebody owns the property next to your place and wants to put up some kind of a factory on that property, golly, they'll do it. I know, the government might stop them today, but then the government will turn around and they'll put their factory there. And then there's no way of stopping them because they got bigger tools, you know. They've got the guns. So they'll do it. What should be explained, it seems to me, when you acquired your property in the first place, is that when you bought your property, you didn't buy the whole neighborhood. Your property is bounded by these boundaries, and within those boundaries, you are sovereign. But if you want to be sovereign of the neighborhood, you got to buy the whole neighborhood. And if you can't do it, then find another neighborhood. Or go out in the country and buy up 100 acres and put your house in the middle. And then you own all around you. They can't get closer than that, than the periphery that you own. Or the other thing, and you could use manners here, I suppose, you could go to your neighbors and say, look, here's what I would hope you'll cooperate with me, and I'll cooperate with you, and you can do that. But I think one thing that does happen to in our particular society, I think we get so involved with the government, and the government is always telling us how they're going to guarantee all these things. And my dear, when the government says to you, now, this makes you safe, or this secures you, this guarantees, duck. Because they don't make anybody safe. You know, that's ridiculous. When they start saying that, you head for the cyclone cellar, because you're about to be wiped. So the answer, and the only answer I know of, relates to, and you raised a good question before you got into this factory next door to you, because I think there are places where you do have to be precise. And this deals in places where you are working with, particularly with other people's property. For example, if you are a trustee and you are looking after another person's money or land or whatever, as a trustee, you really can't be too gracious. You cannot be too tolerant of people that might, unbeknownst to you, commit a trespass. They just better not. And consequently, it seems to me that in a case of that sort, and I can think, and it's not just being a trustee, let me include here, if you're running a business, you can't be called a namby-pamby about your balance sheet. Oh, wouldn't it be nice if you had enough money to pay your bills? Yeah, it'd be real nice. But you better have the money to pay what you promised to pay. And that isn't a bagasse and a bagosh. It's a right here. And it has to be precise. So there is a place for the moral approach, and where you have to be specific and write down to a specific point, as with a trustee, as with a businessman, as with an employee who is working for wages and who has specific chores to perform, he must perform those chores. So it should be. However, that still doesn't eliminate altogether the consideration you can show using a size term, or the tolerance that you can show accepting on matters of precise property lines and ownership of valuables and so on. So there's a place for both, at least in our current society. And I don't see any way out of both at the present time. Dick?
Yeah, Bob, it seems to me that you shifted your ground sort of radically in that answer, and distressingly so. When you began talking about morals, you were giving one-to-one personal examples in areas where property boundaries were vague or undefined. And I thought you made a very good case for the civilized necessity of working these things out with our fellow men. Now, as soon as an economic entity above the individual enters the picture, you know, the alfalfa plant in the lady's example, they bought the property next door, presumably. They didn't buy the air that I breathe. Okay, you've still got exactly the same problem. You've still got the undefined property boundary. Now the offense to my nostrils and the invasion of, quote, my air is much more acute than it was when we just had one individual smoking at the table.
Right.
And yet now you seem to be saying, well, now it's a balance sheet problem. Now it's the bottom line, so manners are out of the window.
Thank you, Dick. No, I didn't mean it. And you're quite right. I'm not trying to suggest that manners are either out the window or that morality is. In fact, I was trying to say that there is a place for both of them in our culture, I think. Obviously, I would have to agree that if pollution comes from a plant and it comes across the boundary, then something has come onto my property. And consequently, that is an intrusion. And from a moral point of view, I have a right, I would contend, to ask them to desist in putting it on my property. Not to desist in doing what they're doing, but to desist in putting it on my property. Now, how they have to do that, I don't know. That's their problem. But they would be engaged in a trespass, in a violation of my boundary. I didn't mean to suggest anything else. In fact, going to the concept of morality right here, the people putting in the alfalfa plant, if they were well-versed in manners and not too adamant about their right to do as they please on their boundaries, they might realize that as an individual, where I would not want to stack my garbage against my fence, even though my side is mine, because the other side could offend my neighbor, they would not want their garbage to violate my boundaries if they're thinking manners and are being considerate of the people in their vicinity. And so I can see an application there for manners. I didn't mean to throw it out the window, nor did I mean to throw the other out either. I think we need both. The usefulness of manners is particularly viable right now in those places where we cannot determine the boundaries with ease. And hopefully we'll be able to do a better job as our techniques, technologies improve. But at the present time, that we are really in limbo there, and the only thing we have is manners. Wayne?
I'd like to point out a situation, I believe, where morality dictates bad manners. And it may just be a semantical problem, I don't know. Suppose you're on the freeway, and for whatever reason, it's heavy traffic, but it's moving along fast. Someone is riding right on your bumper, and it's either inconvenient or impossible for you to pull over into another lane so that he may pass you. You know, the traffic stacked up in front of you.
I'm familiar
and
with
he's
it.
Not going to get there any faster by you pulling over. What I find myself doing as a survival tactic is hitting my brakes to scare him off. Because if I don't do that, sure enough, if there's an accident ahead and I have to hit my brakes in an emergency, he will be slamming into the back of me. So I'd rather give him that warning, which could be interpreted as bad manners, and surely will get him upset with me. That's a survival tactic. It's a moral thing to do, but it's bad manners.
I don't know that it's bad manners. You are acting actually in consideration of him. You're helping to keep him out of an accident, aren't you?
Maybe that's a poor example.
Well, I think it's... I'm not so certain. You know, sometimes the best manners you can show relate to giving somebody a good tongue-lashing that they have coming. It's not necessarily bad manners. It's how you do it. See, it, I'm not trying to suggest that good manners is nothing but sticky, syrupy, you know, not at all. And it's good morals and good manners sometimes to let somebody know exactly what they're doing, and but do it in a nice way. You don't, you know, you don't have to refer to their ancestry. You can, you know, just keep it clean.
Well, perhaps we can define good manners as appropriate or behavior appropriate to the situation.
I think it works like this for me anyway. If I can keep my feelings out of it, I'm okay on the manners part of it. I have to watch this very carefully with myself, and I'm not getting any better as I get older. I'm sorry, people. I really thought I was getting this thing under control, and that by the time I got to be my present age, I would just be purring like a kitten, and there'd just be no way I could get upset. And I tell you, I'm a disappointment to me. I can get just so riled up, you just wouldn't believe it. I don't believe it myself. I get riled up, and I hear that echo in the room. Did I say that? I did. And I said it that loud. And I meant it that way, too, by golly. Oh. So I hope that's not bad manners. It's just, well, as I've often said, if you'd taken my course, you would know, I've often deplored the probability that the French can never be truly civilized. yes, indeed.
I follow your line of reasoning, and I would concur under your definition of morality. What if morality were a little more broadly defined, for example, to it that which argues for the existence of the species? And I think if it were defined that way, it probably would encompass the golden rule more times than not, and would certainly be a guide toward that which you refer to as manners. Let us take an example of my neighbor and myself walking through the woods, and I'm aware of a bear trap just around the bend behind that big tree, but he is not. And it is certainly my right under your moral definition of property that I say nothing. And he,
it depends on whose bear trap it is.
Well, it is not mine.
It's not yours. I didn't know.
And it isn't on my land, nor his.
Right. Gotcha.
It is my right to say nothing, and he winds up with an amputated leg.
Yes.
That is not really arguing for the species, certainly. It is my right to say nothing. Morally, you would say I'm in the correct stance. But morally, I would say I'm not. That if I were to argue for the existence of mankind, I would say, look out, Will, there's a trap ahead. And cause him to avoid injury.
As a matter of fact, I have no problem with that, Don, and I would like to subscribe to it. It's an excellent illustration of good manners.
But if morality were broadly
yes,
defined,
but no, because I'm afraid of it, Don, for the reason that so often, once you broaden it, then you are told that you have an obligation and you have to do it, and that you are reprehensible if you don't. Now, and then suddenly we become our brother's keepers, and we go down that train of thought again.
It may well be that one doesn't always perceive a property boundary. That's hard to do in many cases, and we err. That would concur with the fact that morality would still be that set of actions, that exercise which argues for the existence of
man. And your position is extremely attractive, and I, in terms of the illustration, I'm heartily for it, as I presume you know I would be. But I would prefer to continue to define that as good manners rather than morality, because, and there has been so much made of this other, and I have to at this point agree with Rand about it. I don't agree with her on several points, but this is one where I do agree with her. I think that in trying to say that morality you see, to me, if it is morality, there is a must here. Just as with the boundary, I must not violate that boundary. There's a requirement. There's a moral yes and no. It's a precise line. So if I am morally involved in the bear trap, then I'm under obligation to say to my friend, you must stay out of that bear trap, or whatever. If he is my friend, I'm sure I would do it in any case, and certainly if I have good manners, I would say it. But Don, what about a man that isn't my friend? And I don't just mean an enemy, but what about someone I don't know? How responsible am I for that trap? Can I let anybody go down that thing without telling them? It's not my trap. It's not my land. And yet I know that that hazard is there. Suddenly, if I am morally involved here, then I have to become a busybody and stick my nose into other people's affairs sooner or later, I think. And I love it as you've offered it. But I hesitate to say that it is a moral obligation for the reasons given.
I wasn't implying that it's a natural duty to feed, clothe, educate the world. It's beyond the resources that it's absurd. I was simply saying that as my action, I can argue for or against the species, and that would seem to be a case where I should argue for the existence, assuming whether I like the man or not. I would not want to be, I'm not going to have his death on my doorstep.
And Don, I feel the same way, and as I think I used in the class that you attended, the illustration of the house that I discovered was burning, and of course I ran to the fire department, not realizing that water put out fires and thinking only the government could do it. But then my father letting me know that I really didn't have an obligation there, because if the man was trying to get rid of his house, he had a right to burn it. And of course my mother, seeing fits at this time, but then I had to go back and talk to the fellow, and he was very grateful that I had gotten the fire department for him. But I feel a lot more comfortable with the idea that morality, by definition, is compulsory. There is a do and a don't, and not a maybe. But a manner permits you to go over that. It goes beyond that point, and under certain conditions, especially where you can't find the for sure, it would be very nice to go over that boundary and say, why not try this? I feel better about that, Don, with all due respects. Yes?
Would you extend the concept of manners in the conceptual realm? For example, let's say I want to get up and talk about evolution. I know I'm going to offend the hell out of some fundamentalist Christians. Now, maybe I wouldn't go over and shout it across their property lines, but I'm talking someplace I know they're present. Would you, I don't think you would, but would you, or how would you extend it if you did?
Well, I would not extend it into the field of communication. I would say, of course, that no one owns the words, and no one owns the ideas. And the consequence is that if you don't want to hear something, if certain words offend and certain ideas disturb you, go home. You know, the minute you get out in a meeting with other people, somebody's very apt to say something that, you know, could turn your stomach, I suppose, or do worse. But if you don't want to run that risk, it's like, while no one has the right to jab their elbow into you, don't ride the bus if it's going to bother you, because if you ride the bus, you're going to get jabbed. Not because anybody wants to jab you, but because that's the nature of bus riding. And if you don't want to experience ideas, don't attend a meeting, because it's usually at meetings ideas are going to be tossed around, and if you've got a delicate stomach about some of them, you better choose your meetings with care or stay home. I'd have to look at it that way.
That's also good news, choosing your meetings with care.
Oh yeah.
As good man.
Correct. And by all means, discriminate. Don't sell people short. Because they make a mistake or two, don't write them off. And because they do a couple of good things, don't elevate them to sainthood. Play it cool.
Well, I'm going to suggest that out of our consideration for people who may have early work mornings, that we end the formal part of the program here. But if you're game to stay for a while, people may want to ask you questions or continue the discussion informally.
Not only am I game, I'm fair game, providing none of you are armed.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.